The avalanche has paved my way, riding over 808s. Shed a tear too soon, baby, désolé. Put my heart in every take on tape. We lack the motherfucking knowledge to debate my case, ain't no way. Fresh my head like Gatorade. Cutting edge, my flow razor blades. In need of a change of pace. Ride along, rainbow road, ain't no race. Falling and falling into orbit, I fade away. My belt alligator tail, bathing and bathing, eh. Bro, my grief, I've been a rabbit, gone smoke my payroll away. On the pavement, they trace my shade. Till then I loosen up, the late crochet. The number is that, at the shadow of the sun I rise. A monster constantly watched by 100 eyes. Fuck their constant lies, killing rappers in abundant sight. Leave inflated ego shrunk in size. Satan is on me. Now that shit is just a courtesy. Cause I'm on top of this shit like your girly. We are masterminded verbally. Burst your fucking bubble if you heard of me. Serpents blindfolded in Burberry. For real, sinking ships, I'm the first to leave. Over the plank, imagination immersively. Stay with the trees like I'm turpentine. If I'm ever on TV, they gotta blur the scenes. Backstep, take your shit, burglary. My rhyme's masterpieces, your rhyme's nursery. Don't be taking nothing personally. Your best efforts been evoking the worst in me. I can't worry about no violence. Egg says she fed up with the nihilist. Promise you gon' die a bitch. Cause when you crumble and fall, I'm a rising stick and rain death on them.
Sky dragon sniper shit.
Thank you. Amen. You go to church?
Wait until you see what a man can do to another man.
Are you saved?
Hey, I care about nothing but my bang. Bitch ain't doing what I'm told. I said fucking with these sanctions. I go blossom, y'all go anxious. I'm too fucking high to stand up. I'm in the center. Y'all envious when I am. Why you flexing a ransom? Drop panties and jaws. Don't oppression ever sweat my Dior's. In the jungle, I've been cold to the touch. Feeling like Ali in 74. Heavenly choirs to heavenly chords. Why you production like amateur born? Lot of talking, y'all ain't ready for war. Ask her disposed like you Jennifer Lawrence. Armed in a bastion. Wake me at 7, I crawl into action. Roll like I'm bound in a Aston. Sword in a wound, you fall in a casket. Pressure compressing your chest. And too many verses, y'all need a second. Ain't no comparing, that's out of question. Y'all go tell them what's my
rolling candy backwards. All golden, I'm shown by double casa. Two max ambidextrous, I trip my head like Ajab. See, confidence is visibly decreased all around us. A vivid lucid dream, that boy isn't who he seems. Squatted shooters, it's Golden State. Go against me, put scars in the bowling lane. Same pattern, 16 and all refrains. Slicing and dicing them bodies like I'm no Wee Wang. Think this tempo might dislocate your joints. Millions on my ceremony, I got 50 like I'm Floyd.
Lavish coronation ceremony.
Some fishy like a koi. I be twisting verses like ignition to the Royce. And it's walking down the city like a warlord. Tell them they're my treasure, we go toe to toe with Fort Knox. This shit unique like F-150 Ford trucks. I might pull up to my own crown and in a horse cart.
As he placed a diamond studded crown on his own head.
You having an ASL class over here? You're such a cutie. Wait. Don't even dare. Your chat is agreeing with me, whether you like it or not. Whether you like it or not. What? I don't know what they're saying. Mm-hmm. Well, anyhow, I just wanted to come and hang out for a little bit. Hope you don't mind. Nice. Yes, much love for you too. Firefox, did I tell you something? I probably didn't. I might or might not be making, a new version, a complete new rework out of this model. Better base, straps. Better straps, higher quality, everything. I've been thinking about it. And you almost fell over. Be careful. I just started kind of trippy, like, oh. Oh boy. But yeah, I've been thinking about it. Mm-hmm. It's only because I love this model so much and I kind of want to make like everything, you know, at least when I got a better base and stuff like that. Yeah. We'll see. I don't know yet. What does that mean? How about you teach me some ASL? Just, what did you just say? I know that means yes. You'd be like, ha la 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 la. Oh, I couldn't see the middle word. You? I understand you and me, but what was in the middle? You watch me. Okay. Just pretend I'm just another one of your viewers. It's fine. There we go. I'm not here. You're fine. Yeah, we all know you're a cutie. You don't, we know. Yes. I just took your entire argument and threw it right back at you. What are you gonna do? Mm-hmm. Uh-oh. I like how your handwriting becomes bigger. What? That was known. I can't make sense of finger gestures. Huh. That's a huge rip for me. Hmm? Just become scribbles at some point. I don't know. It's VR chat just being stupid. Oh, Fox. So wait, you do this? No, wait, what did you do? That? Fox. So it's like that. That and Fox. Ah! Holy crap, I just learned something new. Wow. Teach me how to say you are cute. Is it just that? You'd be like, I wish I could do these fancy finger gestures you can, but I just have a flat hand. Makes me look retarded. What does sassy mean? You don't know? Oh, you don't know? Oh, okay. At least you tried. Kim? Still learn. Oh, you're still learning. I thought I said Kim. I was like, wait, what? That's a weird K, but no, it's not. You're still learning? I mean, yeah. Uh-oh. Just sort of lick them and see what they do.
Shh, don't tell them I said that.
Oh, whoa. Oh, whoa. Okay. Wow. All right, I see. Wait, my feet hurts, obviously. God damn it. There you go. Is this sit on here? Oh, almost. Wait. There you go. You are not sorry. Whoa. stepping on your tail. Don't you try to play sad with me, all right? All right? Wow. It's okay. I forgive you. After that headbutt. This is what I'm telling you. There's always a little devil in someone. She's just really good at hiding it. Don't you agree? She's very good at hiding it. Like, do you think this one is an angel? I'm just gonna just do like two devil horns on you because you know. That looks like cat ears. Never mind. Oh boy. What? Chad, how do I look? How do I look? Am I pretty yet? Wait, there's something I'm just gonna check, right? Okay, we're good. Never mind, we're good. Don't try to fool them, you're not a cat. Is that what foxes do nowadays? What? Oh. Wait, where am I? Where am I? What is that supposed to look like? Is that a monkey? What was that supposed to be? A rocket? A spaceship? Firefox is an artist. Can I get that on the print?
let me welcome you to the Golden Gator, where the best of the best come to dab on the haters, where your beautiful waitress might turn out to be your waiter, but I'ma have to catch you later, because
here comes Raffle Gator.
They call him Rob, you know he don't miss. Legit gets to step in or they get the robot fist. He's like, ah!
What a fucked up day.
No mechanical punk's gonna stand in his way. He's a dangerous beast, number one in his class. He survived Curry games stabbing him in the ass. He's so undoubtedly perfect that what more is there to say?
Aw, Yas Queen slay!
He's got so many subs, you'll be left in awe.
Beach is gay confirmed.
Yatta!
The women want him, the men wanna be him. The chat turns on the cam just to see him. Twitch tried to ban him, they got into a scuffle. He walked out within a day doing the desktop shuffle.
I'm the king of VR chat, there's no one I fear.
Rob, stop shouting, yes dear. So now I hope it's plain for you to see. From the crack house to the swamp, the gator is the place to be. And if you're thinking this lobby just ain't for me, well then, perhaps you're better suited to Ascension RP, you chips viewer.
Oh, Firefox, you forgot to mute your mic again. Aw, my little mouth breather. Hey, you like the decorations? This year's Halloween party is gonna be great. We've got Aiden doing entertainment. Flynn's making the food. What could possibly go wrong? Garen's dead.
Kill RP is cringe.
Yeah, mute had it coming.
Looks like there's a killer loose in the bar, honeys. And it could be any one of us.
Damn! He ain't gonna be in Rush Hour 3.
All of the mutes are dead. You're the last one, Firefox. I can't let anything happen to you. Vincent, stand guard and let us know if anybody tries to get in.
No way. Somebody's gonna kill me.
Vincent, they've only been killing mutes. You'll be fine. All right, you should be safe in here. Vincent would have to be a complete idiot to mess this up. God damn it, Vincent.
Boom.
Crumpet? You're the killer?
Yeah, it was me. I'm sick of you spending all your time with those stupid mutes. You never pay any attention to me anymore. Why won't you love me?
Because I'm not gay.
It's VR chat, Rob. Everyone's gay. Now come here, you little bobble-headed bitch. With you out of the picture, there'll be no one left for him to simp for. Say your prayers, Fox girl.
Hey.
Get away from my chair, you bitch. I don't like mutes, but nobody messes with my couch.
It's finally over. All the mutes can rest knowing they've been avenged. We can only imagine what tortures await Crumpet in his own personal hell. Huh? No. Rob, I'm sorry.
Crumpet.
I was joking.
Hey, Crumpet. Crumpet.
God, why did I kill Vincent?
Crumpet. Hey,
Vincent,
Crumpet.
Shut up!
Hey, Crumpet. Crumpet.
watch me decimate. Raising blades and record base. Back to back, my sense is the master key to the master gate. Mass destruction, fucking most wanted in seven states. You grow moist and my voice simple resonate. To heavens I elevate, relative to surface. Rap versus setting in straight. Leveration, Benelli, baby, let it play. Caddy like right snack, deli flavors on any day. Fly the hini like Andini way. All up in your girl's face like NCH. It seems anything but fly like the NCA. Bank account, a land of waste. Get your rental and dentist paid. It's all a prank, bro, your bands are fake. Devouring sour diesel to medicate. Take a hit, your baby lungs hyperventilate. My tape's full of gems like an empty case. On a level you can debate.
Fucking genius, lyrical behemoth. Puzzling the pieces, savior like Jesus. Trying to move the masses, telekinesis. Silky smooth, all butter like Reese's.
Fucking genius, lyrical behemoth. Puzzling the pieces, savior like Jesus. Trying to move the masses, telekinesis. Silky smooth, all butter like Reese's.
Man, I love this shit. I swear to God, I love this shit. Lyrical behemoth, I'm trying to be like He-Man. Letters meet and relish, but can't relish in the feast now. Adding up my feats like Jesus. Jake got bars, man, that's way, way better than behind cell doors. Headlock, wrist lock, man, the pin got scars. Ain't no lions in my raps when I say two Glocks raw. No bites, just free flights, no snitch to God. Swear it's hard to be a genius with these devil bras. Devil bras, devil eggs, they both finger fools. Listen to my speaking and you see what I make figures do. That figure group, figure number eight, I swear I skate off with a mill or two. A milli really only is just built up from a cent or two. A centia, I'm sentient, I'm feeling some designer shoes. Yeah, I'm just a wearer, I'm a slitty mess, a drippy pooler. Ooey gooey wax, she hit me chest is next, you're out of breath. Out here taking G hits, be thankful that it's coming from a genius.
Lyrical behemoth, puzzling the pieces. Savior like Jesus, trying to move the masses. Telekinesis, silky smooth, all butter like Reese's.
Fucking genius, lyrical behemoth, puzzling the pieces. Savior like Jesus, trying to move the masses. Telekinesis, silky smooth, all butter like Reese's.
Firefox.
How's it going? What? You're booping me? No. My one weakness. How you been today? You're doing great. I love you. I accept that.
Have a hug.
Hey, hug time. It's good to see you. Did you have a good weekend? Yeah, that's super good. That's super good. Okay, I'm ready. I got more art? You got more art? Are you one of those art fiends that keeps commissioning your artists, or did people give you art? One of those, like, why not both? Oh, you got it for free? Wow. You know, I have something to say about that. Here, let me take a look at the pen. It's my turn. I'll do it. Okay. Here we go. All right. We'll do one of these little fancy things, and we'll throw like a fancy heart up here for everyone. There you go. There. Draw more art of Firefox. Do it. More art. We need more. It's mandatory. It's a war crime if you don't make art. Once I get paid again, I'm gonna you're gonna commission? Nice! That'll be great! See, that's so wonderful. I love the sound of that. You got anything in mind? You gonna do like a cool cyberpunk commission or anything like that? Yeah, maybe? That'd be super cool. Oh yeah, seeing all the art that comes out of the lobby, especially for specific, you know who gets like an obscene amount of art that I've noticed? It's Murder Crumpet. He gets so much art. Have you noticed that too? Yeah. It's crazy. I've been sitting there just a little bit, like, don't get me wrong, it's not like the venomous kind, but like a mild bit of jealousy. Cause like, it's so neat. It's so cool the work they do, you know? Yeah, it's really interesting. We all love getting, oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, it's really flattering. And it's so touching when it's a surprise. I had one person surprise me fairly recently by the name of Rokaki. It's this really, really sweet, beautiful little piece. Remind me to show it to you later. Just hit me up in DMs or something, because I'll forget. I'm Papega. You know, I've got like no memory. It's like a goldfish in there. But yeah, I'll show it to you later. It melted me. It was like a s'mores bar. So what you up to? You gonna do like roaming about, or are you just doing a quick stop through friends? I call it a friend patrol when you go visit friends. You doing one of those? That's super cool. Most of my friends are, oh, they're offline. Yeah, they're offline. Yeah, I noticed that too. Like a lot of the late night crowd, they stay up so late. I know you've noticed that. I kind of keep old man hours. By the time it hits like 11 p.m. PST, I'm usually out of the lobby. And that's just because, like, I don't know, I like sleep and I like being lazy, and I also indulge in candy-like things that are filled with legal substances here in Washington State. And so, you know, in the evening hours, I like to just kind of veg out and just do my thing and hang out with friends, and it's a good time. But because people tend to stay up so late, like, Jay is a machine. I don't know how Jay does it. She stays up super late and then starts earlier than me. What the heck is up with that? That's crazy. It's bonkers. I stay. I stay up to 4 a.m. MST. So you're over in like the Denver-ish kind of time zone. Start stream. You start stream at 1 p.m.? You literally go to bed at 4, you sleep for like 8 hours, you wake up, maybe have a small breakfast, and just kick on stream. You're so crazy. That's so cool. I admire everyone who has that level of energy. It's so interesting. Like, for me, I don't know, like, maybe I'm just so invested in just talking nonstop for like 2-3 hours that it uses up a lot of my daily energy at once, right? It could be. But regardless of whether or not I do that, you have the ability to, because I've seen you, you'll stream for hours, and you do that hand ASMR thing. I remember when he did that to me in the street after Rob was maybe get up. You remember when Rob made me do that thing up at the wall where I put my arms up? And yeah. And you came up and you started doing the hand ASMR thing. Like, my head turned off. I don't know how you do that, but it straight up just shut off. Like, nothing was happening. It was error 404, Goku not found. And I was just passed out, just in my head, looking at you. And it's just like, it's so crazy. And so I know I like to watch your stuff because, like, you do that sometimes with the chat. You'll just hang out, you'll write them nice messages, and you'll do your cool hand magic. It's just a vibe. It's really good. You do great stuff for people. It's really, like, conducive to a positive emotional experience. Oh, thank you. I love. Aww. I love your. Positivity. Aww. Yeah, come on. That calls for another one. Yeah. Two hugs. Pog. You're a gem, Firefox. You just keep doing that because, like, what you do for people, it's huge. It really is. What's that? What's that mean? What is this? Same. Okay, so this means like same. Yeah, is it this way? Is it facing? It's facing. Okay, cool. I didn't know if that was like shaking the water out of your phone. Like this. I'm not good at sign language. I try my best. I do know this one though. Let me see if I can do it in VR. I think I did it right. I was in the army. Out of character, I was in the army, just saying, I learned some things. Well, hey, you know, I don't have a lot going on today, but I'm planning on streaming more VR chat, you know. One of the big things is because of the DMCA stuff, like I'm dropping character here for a second. I have to be kind of careful with this. I can't do it a lot because at a certain point then I'm threatening copyright. Because if you sound like the character and you look like the character and you act like the character, at a certain point you're literally just the character. And so that's why I haven't seen a lot of me in the lobby. I've been trying to figure out what to do. And I think as long as I don't do it excessively, it's not a big deal. That is... That is... T-A... Terrible. Yeah. Well, yeah, it's just one of those things we have to adapt to for the time being. Like, I'm all about people getting, you know, intellectual property control. I don't have any issue with that. It's like with the music artists and stuff, right? Really what they want is just their fair share of the experience, right? And I wouldn't mind giving them a cut of whatever I brought in from Twitch to have the right to play their music. Like, I really don't mind people getting their fair share. But the lobby should still be fine. And I'm doing this once or twice a month. But you might, if you still join on me, you might catch me doing Aaron or running around as me. Or even I might pull out Camille and that's my lady. I can actually do a pretty convincing lady. So I have fun with the voice acting stuff. I just wanted you to be prepared for that. So when you come in and you see me not being Goku, it's not too weird. Your Goku is... phenomenal. Oh, dude, Firefly, dude, you're gonna kill me, dude. You're gonna kill me. You're such a sweetie.
Headpats. Yeah, you're such a gem. You're so cute.
That really means a lot. Yeah, it's fun to do like the impression and stuff, but it's been really a fantastic tool for learning voice acting. So who knows? Maybe at some point I can have my own character and not just voice that, but bring it to life too. Who knows, right? So, did you have anything you wanted to do, or getting ready to hop to another world? Yeah? Okay, well, tell you what, Tuesday this week, I will be stopping by the lobby. I will also be streaming VR tomorrow, so if you want to stop by during your normal hours, you're welcome to, too. We could also do an adventure if you want. I like to go New World hopping at least once a week. So if you want to do something like that, we could go check out New Worlds. That might be really cool. What do you think? Do you want to maybe do something like that? If not, even tomorrow, we could do it sometime soon. Cool. All right. Well, let's get a hug out of the way, and you can get back to your wonderful caretaking of all your beautiful people. And have just a really good day, Firefox, okay? I mean it. You deserve to have the best kind of days, okay? Okay. All right. Double high five and you can go. Let's get it. Legend. All right, sweetheart. Okay. You go kill it. And then I get to yell at someone. Because I'm going to yell at someone.
Vsauce, Michael here. It falls down. So that's which way down is. It's the direction gravity is pulling everything in. Now, for someone on the other side of the Earth, my down is their up. But where are falling things going? Why do things fall? Are they being pushed or pulled? Or is it because of time travel? First things first, let's turn the sun into a black hole. We can do that using Universe Sandbox 2. This simulator will blow your mind. I love it. In fact, I love it so much, I put a code to get the game for free in the current Curiosity Box. If you're not subscribed to the box yet, you're missing out. Okay, look, for the purposes of this video, we want the solar system. And here it is. Notice that everything's moving pretty quickly around the sun. That's because we currently have the game set so that every second that passes for us is 14 days almost in the game. If I change this to 1 second, we're looking at the solar system in real time. You'll notice that it almost looks like it's frozen. Even though the Earth is traveling around the sun at about 30 kilometers per second, it barely appears to be moving. That is how vast space is. Anyway, let's go back to 14 days. I like that motion. Now look at the sun. It is not currently a black hole, but we can change that. What we need to do is compress the sun. So let's lock its mass so that it doesn't change while we make its radius smaller. Let's make its radius as small as we can, and, oh, where'd it go? Well, it's still there, it's become a black hole. But now, let's look at the rest of the solar system. All right, zooming out, and, nothing's changed. I mean, something's changed, it's colder and darker, nothing's flying off into space or getting sucked in. You see, by shrinking the sun, we didn't change the direction of down for the planets. They're always being pulled by gravity towards its middle, and making it smaller didn't move where the middle was. But also, the strength of that force pulling them to the middle of the sun stayed the same. That gives us a clue as to what down is. The clue is the other thing we didn't change: mass. Mass is a measure of how hard it is to accelerate something, to change its motion. Now, right now, these two balls have zero motion relative to me. Slapping around this hollow plastic ball is pretty easy. But doing the same to this solid steel ball is a lot harder. Now, gravity and weight have nothing to do with this. Gravity acts downward, not against my horizontal slapping. Of course, gravity does contribute to friction, but friction works against me when I start moving the ball, but works with me when I stop the ball. And the steel ball is harder to stop than the plastic ball. The difference is mass. The steel ball is more massive. It's more resistant to having its motion changed. Mass is an intrinsic property. It does not depend on what's around or change from place to place. It can sometimes be thought of as the amount of matter something has. Your mass is the same regardless of where you are, on the moon, on Earth, in the middle of intergalactic space floating around. But all of this said, mass does seem to care about what's around. Mass loves company. Things with mass and or energy are attracted together by a force that we call gravity. The feeling of gravity is just you and the Earth being attracted to one another. Now, every portion of an object with mass attracts other portions towards it. The average of all this pulling is an attraction between centers of mass. Giant things like Earth exert an obvious pull, but everything does, even a baseball. These two baseballs are attracted together by their own gravities. Except their masses are so small, the force is minuscule, and it can't overcome friction or push air out of the way. They're never gonna come together. But if you put two baseballs 1 meter apart in the middle of empty space where no other forces could act on them, they would literally fall together and collide. It would take 3 days to happen, but it would. Isaac Newton found that the strength of the force bringing two things together is equal to the product of their masses divided by the distance between their centers of mass squared times big G, the gravitational constant. If you make one of two objects more massive or move them closer together, the force will be stronger. And this force of attraction is what we call weight. So mass is intrinsic, whereas weight depends on what's around. Now, a weird thing happens when you weigh yourself on most scales. Weight is a force, but scales display pounds or kilograms, which are units of mass. What's going on is that a scale is activated by a force, any force. It doesn't have to be caused by gravity. The scale then displays what amount of mass near the surface of the Earth would be attracted to the Earth with the force it's detecting. Now, since scales tend to be used on the surface of the Earth by people on which the only force acting is gravity, they tend to not be very far off, but they can be easily tricked, and they further lead to the confusion between mass and weight. Notice that weight is mutual. You are pulled down by Earth with the same force that you pull up on Earth. According to a scale, I weigh 180 pounds on Earth. And the Earth weighs 180 pounds on me. But because the Earth's mass is so much greater than my own, and because the more massive something is, the more it resists being moved, our equal and opposite weight forces accelerate me a lot more than the Earth. If you drop a pencil from a height of 6 feet, the pencil doesn't just fall to the Earth. More precisely, they both come together. They're attracted to each other by equal forces, but the same force moves the pencil a lot more than the Earth. When you let go of the pencil, the Earth is literally pulled up to the pencil by the pencil's own gravity, a distance equal to about 9 trillion.
Hi, you cutie.
The
I'm
width
back.
Of a proton. That same force moves the pencil the remaining distance.
Seriously,
which is still
like,
pretty much 6 feet.
You're the only one.
At the height of the International Space Station's orbit, you
enter
and
a private world. Stays orange, or isn't a public right
surface.
Now. And I'm
about
like, nah.
8.8 times your mass.
Nah, I'm gonna join this sweet
but
bean.
Not zero.
And we just
for
hang
this reason,
out.
Weightless astronauts in zero gravity are neither weightless nor
what?
In zero
what?
Gravity. Their weight force fails to bring them and Earth
you
together
look shiny.
Because they move horizontally.
So why are you so shiny?
They fall just as fast as Earth.
You look like a glossy statue.
Even though
you look fine.
90% of the gravity you and I are feeling right now, that's why they don't just fly away. There are no forces called G forces to resist their weight, since everything around them is falling too. It's resistance to your weight force, stress, deformation that is needed for you to feel weight. What an orbit actually lack is apparent weight. Likewise, a helium balloon has weight. I mean, it's made out of matter. It clearly has mass, so it's attracted to the Earth. Let's try to measure its weight force. Okay, it has negative apparent weight. That's because its attraction to the Earth is weaker than the buoyant forces from the air around it that push it up. Now, while it moves up, it pushes air molecules down, but they transfer that force widely, not just directly down onto the scale. Buoyant forces are caused by the fact that whenever you are immersed in a fluid, like water or air. Molecules lower down are at greater pressure. They're being pressed by the weight of all the molecules above them and are closer to Earth, so they're pulled to it with a stronger force. Now, having greater pressure means they pack a bigger punch when they collide with things. So, horizontally, those collisions cancel out. But vertically, the stronger collisions from below went out, providing lift, a buoyant force. Now, this even happens on your own body. Across its surface area, a force of about 1 newton, which is equal to the weight force of an apple. So if you weighed yourself in a vacuum, you would weigh about this much more. But that's not all. Earth's spin causes it to bulge at the equator. So the closer you are to it, the further you are from Earth's center of mass, and the less your actual gravitational weight will be. Down is always changing. I mean, where is Earth's center of mass? It would always be the same as Earth's geometric middle if Earth's composition was uniform, but Earth contains pockets of massive rock at different depths, water, mountains. It's got moving, changing insides and air and seasonal ice. And though they're far away, gravity extends forever from everything. So the moon, the sun, the planets, all of them pull on you negligibly, but truly. You weigh about a millionth of your weight less when the moon is directly above you. This chunky, shifting balance of material on Earth and everywhere else in the universe means that down is always changing. On top of that, Earth's spin skews what you consider the direction of down away from its center of mass, because the push you get from Earth's spin seems to slightly lift you, reducing your apparent weight and bending down towards the equator. The net result is an apparent weight reduction at the equator of about 0.5%. If a scale guesses your mass must be 200 pounds at the poles, it'll guess that you're 199 at the equator. The 9.8 multiplier used so often in physics is calculated based on how these factors affect someone at 45 degrees latitude. All of these influences on the direction of down result in a total vertical deflection that's only ever at most a few arc seconds anywhere on Earth. That's not enough to be felt, but changes in direction and strength can be used to study the shape of the seafloor, determine what's under you, or even help you discover ancient buried rooms. Point is, all of our downs aren't a bunch of radially symmetric lines. Down is an uncombed mess. Now, since solids don't flow, they can have shapes that don't pay much mind to this. But water can flow. So, ignoring influences like wind and tides, the surface of oceans and lakes and puddles is always perpendicular to down. If water could pass through land, or if Earth were submerged in water, gravity would be the same everywhere along its bumpy surface. Such a surface is called a geoid, and can be drawn at any altitude. If you wanted to build a table that completely enclosed the Earth, it would have to have rolling undulations, nearly 100 meters at some points, in order to be level, so that a ball placed anywhere on it wouldn't roll. Here is Earth's geoid exaggerated 1,000 times. You'd weigh about 0.1% less, a few grams, here than you would say here, where gravity is a bit stronger. Point is, the strength and direction of down is variable by location and changes over time. So, down is a fluctuating vector. Easy enough. Except, why should matter attract matter in the first place? Isaac Newton was able to describe attraction, but not explain it. Humanity got closer, however, when Albert Einstein introduced his general theory of relativity. Einstein thought a lot about the fact that everything falls to the ground at the same rate. No matter how massive something is, when dropped, it will accelerate towards the Earth down, gaining about 9.8 meters per second for every second that it falls. That means that a hammer, that's quite massive, and a not-so-massive feather, when dropped from the same height, will hit the ground at the same time. Okay, what just happened was an error. In order to fall through air, a thing has to push air out of the way. But if it has a large surface area and a low weight force, it will have a lot of air to move, but won't be able to move that air very quickly. In a vacuum, things do fall at the same rate regardless of mass. This was famously demonstrated by Apollo 15 Commander David Scott on the moon.
And I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that?
That's weird, right? I mean, if a more massive object is pulled with a greater force, shouldn't it fall faster? Well, Newton's explanation was simple. Larger masses are attracted with greater forces, but will also require more force to be accelerated the same as a less massive thing. Something 100 times more massive might require 100 times the force, but it will be pulled by gravity 100 times more. So everything falls to Earth at the same rate. What a fun coincidence, right? Maybe not. Einstein realized that there's another way for things to appear to fall together regardless of their masses. Imagine a feather and a hammer floating in space, in a room. If the room is suddenly accelerated up at 9.8 meters per second squared, the feather and the hammer will hit the floor at the same time. Furthermore, whether it's the room coming up to meet them or gravity being suddenly switched on, neither object will feel any force pushing them. There's no way to tell which of these happened. This is Einstein's famous equivalence principle. He once admitted that his greatest thought ever was that of a man falling off of a roof. While falling, the man would not feel any forces on him, even though he's speeding up. Free fall is indistinguishable from floating alone in space, from having no forces on you, from not being moved. What if gravity isn't a force at all? What if things fall not because they're being pushed or pulled, but because they're not being pushed or pulled? To see how this could be, we need to talk about straight lines. What I have here is a retractable ID badge holder. This is a great way to test for straight paths because the string is always kept taut. The card I have behind has two lines drawn on it, and if while I pull the string out, it always stays between those two lines, I will know that I never turned while I pulled it, because any turn will translate into a different angle between the lines on the card and the string. Now, if I put two of these on a flat table and pull them out, always ensuring that they go straight ahead, they will never meet. They will be forever parallel. But now, let's put them on a sphere, a curved surface. Again, I pull both strings forward, making sure that they always are pulled out straight, no turning. Wait, they came together. Well, they didn't turn. Look, maybe there's some kind of weird force that pulled my hands together. And just like gravity, I didn't feel it, but it happened. No, what happened was not the result of a force. It was just a natural result of curvature. You might be thinking, wait a second, are those really straight lines? I mean, they don't look that straight to me. Also, what if they just moved along latitude lines? Then they'd never come together, and those look pretty darn straight. But they're not. A straight line never turns. And although latitude lines look straight at first glance, following one requires turning. To find straight line paths on surfaces, whether they're flat like this or curved, I love the ribbon test. Now you can use an actual ribbon, but I have found that a strip of paper works even better. Let's take a look at this path right here. It's straight at first, but then it curves. Now if two people are traveling along this curve and they want to stay together, the person on the inside will have to cover a shorter distance than the person on the outside. Since both sides of this strip of paper cannot change their lengths, they'll help us find a straight path. If the strip of paper can lay flat, we'll know that we have found a straight line. And as you can see, the strip can lay flat and follow the straight part of this path. But when it comes to the curve, in order to follow the path now, the strip, well, it has too much material on the inside, and that material bunches up and leaves the plane. Therefore, we know that this part of the path is not straight. Let's use the ribbon test to find straight lines on the surface of a cone. Well, from the looks of it, a line directly from the base to the tip seems like it would be straight, and sure enough, yeah, the ribbon lays flat on that path. But what about a ring around the cone? Nope, doesn't work. Shorter distances around nearer the tip of the cone mean that there's too much ribbon up at the top, so it doesn't lay flat. Let's see, what else is there, though, besides this? Well, if I start here and just allow the ribbon to lay flat, I get a little curvy-looking shape like this. I say curvy-looking because while to someone, say, at the base, this path might seem to go up, slow down, change direction, and then fall down faster and faster, since a ribbon on such a path is flat, it's actually, for inhabitants on the cone's surface, perfectly straight. If we trace the ribbon's path onto the cone, we can see this clearly because a cone can be flattened. A straight line on a curved surface is called a geodesic. Here is a geodesic on a sphere. The equator is one. Here's another. A line of latitude is not a geodesic, it's not a straight line. To see why, let's try to follow it with the ribbon. You know what? I have to keep kind of lifting it. Yeah, see, distances around the sphere become shorter as we go up, so there's too much material on the ribbon up here and it leaves the surface. This path contains turns, and in order to turn, a force has to act on you. If no forces did, this is the path you would take. Notice that the ribbon begins moving due east, but then falls south. Falls. Einstein realized that curvature could cause things to be seemingly attracted to one another without needing to invent the existence of forces like gravity. But attraction only happens if things move along the surface. If they stay still, they don't come together. So for something at rest, how does falling begin? I mean, the thing has to move in this direction, but it's at rest, right? Well, yes, but it's only at rest in space, and that's not the whole story. Up, down, forward, backward, and left, right are all you need to describe where an event occurred. But a complete description will also need to describe when. Together, these four dimensions form the setting in which everything in our universe happens. Space-time. Since we can talk about a falling pencil using just one spatial dimension, up and down, we can use a piece of paper to model space-time for it. Okay, so we've got up and down, but we have to add another direction the pencil moves in. Time. Now, if no forces act on the pencil, it won't move through space. It will only get older. And as you can see, if all it does is get older, it won't fall. If space-time was flat, when I let go of the pencil, it wouldn't go anywhere. But now let's allow the Earth, which is massive, to manipulate space-time into, say, a cone. Now, with no forces acting on it, every part of the pencil follows a straight line. But on a cone, as we saw earlier, such a path will look like this. It will fall. This is because distances around the cone are shorter, higher up. Time runs faster, further from a massive object. But to go straight, not turn, every part of the pencil must cover an equal distance in space-time, like this. Only when the pencil hits the Earth does the repulsion of their mutual electrons provide a force pushing the pencil off a geodesic. For the Earth, time is a series of slices from this evolution. The pencil's force-free geodesic is why it falls. Not a push or pull, just the pencil's natural tendency to follow a straight line until something acts on it. Now, we only used one dimension of space and one of time, because visualizing our universe's three of space and one of time would take us beyond the limits of what could be shown on paper or screens. But math can take us there. General relativity allows us to calculate how much mass and energy curve space-time, and has been used to explain things that Newton's older theory of falling as the result of forces couldn't, like anomalies in the orbit of Mercury, which orbits nearest the Sun and is therefore most affected by the Sun's grip on space-time. Many other experiments have confirmed general relativity's picture of the universe, fitting the conclusion that there is no gravity. There's just space-time, its curvature, and us in it. As John Wheeler famously put it, space-time grips mass, telling it how to move. Mass grips space-time, telling it how to curve. Relative to the Earth, we don't move very fast. Even jet airplanes move negligibly close to the speed of light. So relative to Earth, we move almost exclusively through time. As such, we are more affected by the way time is curved by mass than how space is curved. This has led many to claim that for the most part, you feel as though you're being pushed into the ground, not because of a force called gravity, but because time is moving faster for your head than for your feet. Down is relative and always changing, but it exists because of and is always in the direction of slower time. Bertrand Russell called this the law of cosmic laziness. Everything is naturally steered towards where time is slowest. We call this falling, going down. So you don't have to keep anything on the down low. Time will take care of that for you. And as always, thanks for watching. Remember that you can support Vsauce and Alzheimer's research by subscribing to the Vsauce Curiosity Box. The current one comes with a code to get a free copy of Universe Sandbox 2, which is amazing, and a whole host of other science toys and tools picked by myself, Jake, and Kevin. I love it. Also, I hope to see you at Brain Candy Live. We are coming to many, many cities very soon, hopefully one near you. By going to the show, you can see Adam and I doing things that, well, you may not have seen us do before. We also explore the science and common misconceptions behind all things air? Maybe I've said too much, maybe not. I hope to see you there. And, as always, thanks for watching.
You! Me? I am from the future. I'm here to stop you from doing something incredibly stupid.
Oh. Okay. I guess that's good. What did I do?
You broke one of the most important rules of time travel. Now listen to me. Under no circumstances can you... Hello, Kyle? And Kyle? I am Kyle from the year 2175.
But you haven't aged.
That's... Shut up. I'm here because I need to change the past.
Yeah, I was here first. You probably should have anticipated that.
What's with the glasses? The future is bright.
Nice.
That wasn't a joke.
Oh.
The sun expanded and the planet caught on fire, and all because you do something really stupid.
It is looking that way.
Don't listen to anything he says. I'm from his future, and what he's not telling you is that he's the one who blew the sun up. Liar!
No, I did. It was a bad idea, though. Okay, I'm still not getting the whole exploding sun thing, but you two are the same person, right? Like, your future him? So that means you also did the whatever. Sorry to interrupt, but about an hour from now, you get distracted thinking about all this, and then you accidentally burn your grilled cheese sandwich. Do you think you could do something about that?
Okay, hold on. How could I get time travel technology in 1 hour?
It's a long story.
How? How long could it possibly be?
About an hour.
Oh, hey, what's up?
When are you from?
Oh, I'm not a time traveler. I'm your twin brother.
I don't have a twin.
You do in the future.
Okay, will somebody just tell me why you're all here?
We're here to stop you from traveling back in time and having a conversation with yourself.
See you in an hour.
Yeah, looking forward to it.
Did you not see the... see the title of the video.
Gorn!
Without a doubt, Gorn is one of the best games ever made. Like a modern-day stress ball on steroids. For those who don't know, Gorn is a gladiator-style combat game where you take out all your suppressed rage surrounding our torturous existence, where we fruitlessly strive only to create more responsibility that inevitably piles up until we uncontrollably crumble under the weight of our own hubris.
Sorry, I sort of blacked out there for a second. Where did all this blood come from?
Whilst being the best game ever created, it's still only early access. Jesus, I'd hate to play Gorn in 10 years from now when it's finally finished and have to continue life after experiencing what would ostensibly be the zenith of absolute perfection.
I can't go back!
It just makes me think if God was a developer, we'd definitely still be early access. It even now has an incredibly impressive giant crab monster. Alright, bye. And those close to me know how I feel about crabs. I tell you what though, fighting this thing even makes me feel bad as we crack away at its precious shell, exposing the soft vital organs that lay underneath. I tell you, I'm never hurting another crab again.
Oh yeah.
What makes Gorn so good is its incredible precision. Whatever you want to do, you just do it and it works every time. The throwing is especially well-tuned. Where the fuck is that going? You can grab an enemy on any part of their body and it connects perfectly. And before you know it, bang, bing, bosh, and he'll never walk again. I'm dead inside. Wait. Wait. Ah! Wait a second, what's this? Oh, I see. See, here's your problem. You've got to turn this off. Oh my god, I'm so sorry! Get off. I told you, it's time for bed. Put on your pajamas. Hi. Oh, there I go. Blade and Sorcery is basically a combat game where you hit people and have a good time. You start the game in front of this mirror, and it's a huge testament to how fun VR really is, given how long I stood here simply contorting my dislocated elbows and whacking random objects. I mean, look at that face. You can see she really hates mirrors. We still haven't left the first room yet. You quickly learn about the best part of this game, which is picking weapons up off the ground and floating them towards you. The reason this is so good is bending over in VR is fairly immersion breaking, as your center of weight is already slightly askew due to the miniature television you have attached to your face. Like some sort of dystopian future Teletubby.
I have no eyes, but I must see.
As a result, picking up weapons in games like Gorn and Budget Cuts can sometimes be a bit of a pain, but in this game, okay, let's talk about the actual game. Hey, nice day today. When I first started playing Blade and Sorcery, I was a little disappointed because the game appears to be very simple. The game is made up of 4 levels that you don't exactly progress through. You just pick a map you want to go to and fight different waves of enemies there by selecting the type of wave you want to fight. And in many of the game modes, after a few waves, the combat simply ends and you have to walk all the way back to the wave select book, and it breaks up the combat quite substantially. However, I then realized this game was actually early access, so not complete yet. And after playing for a while, I found what made it such an interesting game. You see, there are so many different ways you can play this game. For example, you can electrocute, slit a throat, stab forward, stab back, look into their eyes, look away, jump and stab, drop and stab, glide with your hand, climb with your hand, glide with a weapon, climb with a weapon, hack from the base, hack from the top, change where you hold, rotate the weapon, use telekinesis, slow time, use telekinesis twice, hit with hand, hit with shield, hit with wood, hit with rock, hit with friend, drop a chandelier, dismember, decapitate, make a head collection, make an arm collection, pull them off a ledge, shoot them with arrows, throw your weapon, use two-handed weapons, hit them with a chair, do this, break through guard, go around guard, disarm, disarm with electrocute, dance, throw body, throw head, throw potion, use unstoppable spinning dagger, dodge, duck, chase, lodge, and die. This means the game has what more established game critics would describe as a high skill ceiling.
I knew you were hiding something!
The idea here is that because the game is so complex, there's a huge amount of scope to get very good at it. But because the combat is also seemingly very straightforward, man punch face, it has a very low skill floor.
You're both in on it!
But is the game good? Yeah, it's pretty good. I'd be hesitant to call it a full game yet exactly. It's more of a collection of incredibly impressive mechanics in need of a bit of refinement. Just picking dead people off the floor, for example, is wholly unpleasant as you instantly become a half-blind collection of dislocated limbs.
Oh, a penny.
The combat doesn't yet feel as impactful or precise as Gorn. Oh, this is definitely unfair. But Blade and Sorcery is trying to achieve something very different than Gorn. You see, Gorn in comparison is incredibly polished, and although there is a lot to do, its roster of gameplay mechanics pale in comparison to what you can do in Blade and Sorcery, even though its mechanics are a little janky. Oh, would you come down? Gorn is also more about absolutely annihilating your opponent. Who's bad at sprints now, Mr. Fletcher? Enemies in this game, as well as having the textures of real people, are more defensive and reactive, making the game feel far more realistic. This combined with the obvious amount of effort that's been put into giving the weapons tangible weight so they convincingly lodge themselves into your victim's supple neck tissue, means the whole experience ends up feeling a little more horrifying. All that's missing is a voice that screams, "Have mercy!" as they cowardly flee. Mercy is for the weak.
Maybe there's a helpline I can call.
But like any good Bethesda game, yeah, you mean Obsidian game, right? Some of the jankiness is what makes this game more fun. I remember leaving my controllers on a desk, then walking across the room to find my arms were capable of more than just constantly dislocating. Uh-oh, that's not good.
Help me!
Another thing that makes Blade stand out is the clear amount of time that must have been put into the way all the objects in the game interact. Whatever you think you should be able to do within the range of the mechanics at your disposal is usually possible. You see, Blade's focus is on achieving realism without being too realistic.
That's got to be the best pirate I've ever seen.
So it would seem.
Oh, fuck! Being realistic is stuff like your character walking and climbing at what would be considered a human pace. For example, in Doom, people have measured that your character is effectively breaking the land speed record, and it's fucking great. While realism is simply having gameplay and environments interact in a way that makes sense based on the mechanics we have at our disposal. For me, having lots of realism leads to a far more exciting experience where you organically discover interesting tidbits hidden within the game's mechanics. For example, I originally thought telekinesis was only used to pick up weapons until I accidentally stabbed someone when pulling a knife towards me. Jesus, they never covered that eventuality in Matilda. Anyway, after finding that out, stabbing people with floating knives quickly became my favorite part of the game. I honestly can't get over how fun this is. You see, possibly my favorite scene in X-Men First Class is when Magneto does this. And now I can do it too.
Was ruhen Sie gern zu essen, verlieren?
You can also spin your blades while they're floating, but it's basically like pressing the always win button. Oh man, I don't know about this. The best level for me in the game is the ruins, simply because you can control this hanging chandelier thing that between you and me does absolutely nothing most of the time as it flies through the level, and I honestly wouldn't have it any other way. But you know what's more dangerous than a floating chandelier or a flying knife? Crates.
Ah, I see you've played knifey crate-y before.
It's just a shame there's no mechanic for you accidentally killing yourself. Oh, Blade, vanquish me! Well, something's happening. The game's graphics are fairly average, as I'm sure you've noticed, but that's not really why we're here. So, you read any good books lately? Maybe there are some different visuals past this door. Nope, nothing in there. Plus, if you don't like a certain texture, you get an option in-game to alter it, which is pretty innovative as far as VR games go. Hi, and welcome to Painting with Up Is Not Jump. I'm gonna make myself sick. So today... areas like the market, they're quite nice, for example. What the fuck are these? Is this a 3D mesh with its flat texture right next to it? And who picked this color?
There we go, good as new.
Reality's dogged form will forever haunt my dream.
Wait. It's already technically taped onto my head, so it doesn't make any difference. Are you afraid of pirates?
No. Well, I am. I can't have people hacking my account and getting their hands on all the pictures I have of Sid in a bikini.
Those were meant to be between Khajiit and human.
Really, though, I use ExpressVPN on my phone and laptop when I'm working out of the house and on public Wi-Fi. This is because I know anyone on the same public Wi-Fi can access my phone and internet activity disturbingly easy. ExpressVPN encrypts your internet data, making all your data inaccessible during these kinds of attacks.
I work outside of the house, by the way, mainly because I'm trying to offset the inevitable cabin fever. I'm working, get out!
I also really need ExpressVPN when a game comes out.